Not here, so you're stuck with me for a little while here. We're going to go over a subject that is hot on my memory list because of Gibbs. This is a biblical distinction that we just finished up with not too long ago, and this is a biblical distinction that Pastor did not cover last winter. It's called eternal life quantitative versus qualitative. Quantitative versus qualitative. Before we start, let's just bow our head in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to come and worship together. We're thankful that we can open up your word. We're thankful that we can learn more about you. We're thankful for our eternal life that you provided to us through Jesus Christ. We're thankful that this eternal life can be something that can be of quality while we live here on this earth. We can realize just what we have, our position in Christ, and enjoy a relationship with you. Can make life so much better and so much easier. And we just pray that as we study this tonight, the Spirit of God, you would illuminate our thinking, and we would understand these passages. And I would just build a speak it clearly so that everybody can understand. And we're just thankful for this opportunity. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Pastor, I talked to him not too long ago. He said that his mother is doing better. She's got cellulitis, and she is not taking her medication like she's supposed to. And so the issue is that the effects of the disease or the sickness is catching up to her, and so they're worried about her her memory and stuff. So keep praying for him. He said pray for wisdom for the decisions they got to make, their family. The curse of old age is catching up on all of us very quickly, and as our family members get older, it's very difficult. I can only imagine how I'm going to be like when my children tell me, this is what you're going to do, Dad, and I'm going to say, well, I don't know. So pray for him for wisdom. It's a difficult situation. This biblical distinction, as you recall, we'll do a little bit of a recap, and for your memory, 2 Timothy 2:15, we're to be diligent to present ourselves a worker that needs not to be ashamed, approved unto God, rightly dividing the word of truth. So it's important to understand these biblical distinctions and apply them to our life so we can rightly divide the word of truth. And words are very important. We all remember the word etymology. The etymology is the root meaning of a word. So every word that we look at has a meaning. So when we look at a passage of scripture, we need to understand the context, the content, and then compare scripture with scripture. So the Bible harmonizes, it makes perfect tune and what it's trying to say to us. It never is going to contradict itself. So we're going to look at three different eternal lives that are used in the Word of God. So I'm sure you're saying right away is eternal life, you know, that's something I already have. Eternal life is something that goes on and on and on forever. So what is the comparison about? Well, keep in mind that death also goes on and on forever as well. So understanding these words and their context in the Word of God can help us when we're reading the Word of God, and so that we can convey it to our fellow workers, to our family members, you know, to our spouse and our children. Now, an example of the context is car trunk. That's a real common one. When we talk about a context of a word, a car trunk, are we talking about the word trunk, I should say. Is it a car trunk? Is it an elephant trunk? Is it a tree trunk? Is it a trunk for clothing? Just what kind of trunk is it? So we need to understand these words in their manner that they were designed to be understood. So we get right into this handout. Some key truths to keep in mind. Right in your handout is, it's imperative that you remember the importance of defining words by their context and usage. Their context and use. An example of that is the seven baptisms. We know that there's four dry baptisms and three wet baptisms. So when we see baptism in the Bible, we need to understand at what context are we talking about. Another one is seven deaths. You know, there's seven different types of death. So when you see the word death, you understand just what kind of death we're talking about. So we're talking about context. The next one is, it's important to recognize that the Bible uses the word eternal life in different ways. It's in different ways. So we're going to first look at quantitative eternal life. This is a life in union with God that lasts forever and ever, in contrast to eternal death. The emphasis on this is both the kind of life and the duration. The kind of life and the duration. That's very important to understand. And the next one is a qualitative eternal life. This is a spiritual quality of life, one that's enjoyed with fellowship with God. It involves an inner joy, a purpose, rest, and the fruit of the Spirit experienced in the believer's life. And we're going to look at some key verses here on your handout that show the difference on a lot of these verses. But it's very important to understand the difference between the quantitative life and the qualitative life when you're rightly dividing the word of truth. So the first verse we're going to look at is Matthew 25:46. And these will go away into everlasting punishment. Who are these? These are the unbelievers. And the righteous shall go on to eternal life. You notice the difference here. The difference here is everlasting and punishment. And you also notice some similarities also. Everlasting, again, and eternal. So you can see the difference there. Another one is John 3:16, a verse that we're all very common versed on. It's a verse we all understand and know. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. See the contrast here? You can either perish or you can have everlasting life. One or the other. Note, this is not a kind of life, but a duration of life. We're talking about a duration of life, everlasting life. When we trust Christ our Savior, we receive everlasting life that lasts forever and ever and ever in duration. It's not talking about a quality of life. It's only talking about this quantity. So this has a quantitative feel. Are you guys keeping up? Yell at me if I go too fast. So John 3:36 is the next one. John 3:36 says, he who believes in the Son has eternal life. And he shall not, but he who does not believe shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides in him. This isn't correct on here. This is a typo in this thing, obviously. But you see, also, this is the word here, has. He who believes has. Has is a present tense. It's a present possession. You automatically, when you trust Christ your Savior, you automatically have a relationship with Jesus Christ. You're positionally secure. You possess eternal life. But notice the opposite. The wrath of God. The wrath of God abides on who? The ones that do not believe. Because of their unbelief, the wrath of God is going to abide upon them. So quantitative in nature, because present possession, have a life that lasts forever, or the opposite. The opposite being that you reject the free gift of eternal life. The next one is my clicker quit working. Ross, it quit working on me. Electronics. So the next one we're looking at is John 5:24. You guys actually have it in your handout. John 5:24. Most assuredly I say to you, hears my voice, or my word, and believes in him who sent me, has eternal life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death unto life. Very similar as the previous verse. Has passed is in the perfect tense. It's in the perfect tense. You have passed. What have you passed from? You've passed from judgment to eternal life. This happened at a point in time when you trusted Christ as your Savior. You passed, you were separated from God, you were enemies of God because of your sin, and because of your faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ, you pass from this death unto life. This is a quantitative, because this is a life that goes on and on forever. Thank you. Why ain't it working? That still isn't. I don't know. It's amazing how dependent we become on electronics. How do you change slides? Where do you touch it at? Oh, okay. Okay. So the next one in your handout is, John 10:28, another verse we're very familiar with. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. You notice the contrast here between eternal life. This is a total contrast, eternal life and never perish. This verse reminds us of a perfect relationship positionally that lasts forever and ever. Something that cannot be lost. Versus the opposite, perishing. People that will be separated forever and ever in a place called hell. And you notice this perishing is not talking about annihilation, destroyed eternally, but it talks about a separation. Ah, you got it. Thank you. So eternal life is a present possession to all believers and never can be lost, though it will be experienced fully after death. And you say, what are you talking about? Fully after death. You know, when we read the Word of God, we need to keep these standards in mind, because different authors in the Bible use words in different ways, different styles of writing. Paul was very different, for instance, than John. Paul always used eternal life in a perfect tense. Paul uses this in a qualitative type of fashion. And John did not. John spoke in a present tense in a quantitative type of setting, where John says, for instance, you have everlasting life, you have eternal life. An instance of this where we could show an example of this is in Romans 6:22. Romans 6:22, but now, this is Paul writing, but now, having been set free from sin and having become slaves of God, we become children of God by trusting Christ our Savior. Now we become a slave of God. You have your fruit to holiness and to the end, everlasting life. Your fruit to holiness, and look at this, to your end, eternal life. This is talking futuristic in tense. Futuristic. Another verse here, and having been justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This hope, this future hope of eternal life. You notice how Paul talks about this and something that's going to happen at the end of your life, where it's going to be totally realized. You know, this hope of eternal life is in reference to the future, but Paul also explained it as a present tense possession, something we enjoy with our Father. You know, the eternal life we receive when we place our faith in Jesus Christ alone, it will never be fully consummated or realized until in the future, will it? Because we're always going to be living with this sin curse while we're here. Does this feel like everlasting life to you? When you get up in the morning and your bones creak and you're getting out of bed and thinking, I got to go to work again today, does this feel like everlasting life? So it's going to be future realized in the future and fully enjoyed, you know, after we're raptured or through death. Turn over your Bibles real quick to Titus chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. I'm going to show you one other one where Paul talks about this. These verses were on the PowerPoint already, but this verse is not. Titus chapter 1. Titus chapter 1, verse 1 says, Paul, a bondservant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect and acknowledgement of the truth, which accords with godliness, in hope of eternal life. See them words, in hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised before time began. This is a promise from the foundations of the earth, this hope of eternal life, which Paul talks about in regard to this futuristic tense, something that's going to be fully realized in the future. But there also is eternal life that can be enjoyed in the present also. Now we're going to take a look now and look at qualitative life. We're going to examine that. First of all, before we look at that, turn over in your Bibles to John chapter 10. John chapter 10, we're going to look at another instance of a qualitative life. This whole passage on John chapter 10, I know I mentioned before that John spoke in the aspect of present tense have in a quantitative fashion, but this passage here in John chapter 10 has a qualitative emphasis here. Yeah, notice in verse 7 it says, and then Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. I am the door of the sheep. The Lord Jesus Christ was using an analogy of a sheep or a shepherd in a sheep fold when he said, I am the door of the sheep. Verse 8 says, and whosoever came before me, all thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. Notice now in verse 9, I am the door. If anybody enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The question about this passage is, when you first look at it, is why does it say will be saved? If you think about that for a second, will be saved. Right away, if you look at the previous verses and see what we read, there's a condition on being saved here, isn't there? You have to enter the door, right? You have to take the gift. You have to accept everlasting life. And once you accept everlasting life, you will be saved. Does that make sense? If you enter, this will be the result. You have everlasting life. Notice in verse 10, the thief does not come except to steal and to kill and destroy. But look at the difference here. I have come that you may have life, and then you may have it more abundantly. You know, he's talking here that we can all have eternal life simply by trusting Christ our Savior. But he's saying, don't stop here. Why are you stopping here? You could have this eternal life, and you can have it more abundantly. You could have even more. You can enjoy it in a different level that you could when you did not know Jesus Christ as your Savior. You know, I think of this analogy like a candy bar. When Jake wants a candy bar to eat, you know, when he's feeling like he wants candy, though, you got to get your mindset right here. Does he want a fun-sized candy bar or does he want a king-sized candy bar? He wants to enjoy it more abundantly. He wants the king-sized candy bar. You know what? So this is the mindset. You know, you want this quality and you want an abundance of quality because he's offering it to us. It's just a matter of us taking it and enjoying it. Another example is when you get married and you want to have a relationship with your wife, you don't want to do it on just a semi-low level. You want to enjoy it to the max, don't you? You want to enjoy every part of that relationship with your wife. So you guys understand the concept that we have this eternal life, but we can enjoy it on a more abundant scale when we learn more about Him and learn who He is and all these promises He has for us. Next, let's look at... Oops, I missed that one. John 17:3. And this is eternal life, that you may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. This isn't the verse I'm looking for. Let's turn over to John 17. John 17, let's look at verses 1 through 3. Jesus spoke these words. This is actually the Lord's Prayer. This is actually Jesus Christ praying. This is the real Lord's Prayer. Jesus spoke these words. He lifted his eyes up to heaven. Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you, as you have given him authority over all flesh, and that he should give eternal life to as many as have given him. Notice in verse 3, and this is the eternal life, that you may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. It's a know you. It's a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ, that we can know him and understand this in an intimate type of way. This is qualitative life. We can know him personally through the Word of God, and we can enjoy that relationship with him. Next, let's turn over in our Bibles to Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6. Are you guys understanding this difference now between the quantitative and the qualitative type of life? Because it's, to me, when I first heard it was a little bit confusing until you think of quantity and quality. Quantity meaning an eternal life that lasts forever and ever and ever, and a quality type of life is something we can have if we choose to have that relationship with Christ. Galatians chapter 6. You know, here we see Paul uses eternal life in a qualitative, in the present tense. You're going to see second tense salvation here, your sanctification. The book of Galatians was written to the church at Galatia, and we know that they had some issues with the law. And we know that the law doesn't justify the sinner and sanctify the saint. So Paul addresses this in the first 4.5 chapters. He addresses this legalism problem that they have. And then he spends a little time in chapter 5 on license. And then in chapter 6, the chapter we're going to look at, he takes and makes some practical applications that are relevant based on what he's already talked to him about these issues. Notice in verse 6, chapter 6, verse 6. Let him who is taught the word share it in all good things with him who teaches. It speaks of ministering to others by benefiting of the teaching that is taught to others. I mean, you ever think that the teacher is benefiting from what he is teaching? It's a practical application that when you have to do a message like this and forced to study, you learn a whole lot more. You learn a whole lot more because you're in the Word and you're trying to rightly divide these principles and standards, and they sink in much more than just being taught them like where you are in a chair there. Verse 7 through 9 says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows to the flesh will reap corruption, or will it, he who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. This everlasting life. You know, verse 7 through 9, you see our phrase in there, everlasting life, in the end of chapter 8. And this is talking, you know, about everlasting life in a qualitative manner. You know, because we already know that every person who trusts Christ as Savior has eternal life. So what are we talking here when we say sow to the Spirit in order to reap everlasting life? We already own eternal life. It's a present possession we have. And it says, whoever sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. This is clearly talking about not just having eternal life as a present possession, and something that's going to be in glorification is going to be realized, but this is talking about enjoying abundant life, this relationship that we can have with our Savior every single day. That's a really important aspect to look at there, because someone that doesn't know how to rightly divide the truth can take that and twist that around and think that there's something you could do to earn this everlasting life. And that's clearly not what it's talking about here at all. There it was right here. Here's that phrase. Sows to the Spirit reap everlasting life. This is talking about feeding the Spirit, feeding the Holy Spirit of God, and reaping everlasting life, enjoying this relationship more and more, more so with your Savior. Now we're going to look at on your sheet here, the prohibition, the warning to believers here in this passage of Scriptures is, do not be deceived. What is deception? Deception is a Greek word, plano, which means to be deceived or led astray. It's where we get the word planets, things that are moving up in the air, planets. Deception is leading someone to believe something that is not true. The creation of a belief in our mind which is in contrast to fact or reality. You know, I think of that, and I think of these new goggles that they have nowadays where you can get these goggles and you can put them on, and I don't know if you hook to your phone, but you can watch, you can swim with the sharks in the ocean, or you can fly a jet in the sky, and you're looking through these goggles and you're actually doing everything that it's doing, and so you're living in this unreality. It's a reality in your mind, but it's a deception because it's really not true. You're being deceived. You know, deception can be self-induced or it can be passed on from others. You know, none of us are exempt, are we? We're all deceived every single day. So Paul is saying to these folks here, these church of Galatia, is stop allowing yourself to be deceived. It's in the imperative voice, it's a command. It's one thing to get deceived by a con man one time, but to do it over and over and over again is wrong. So then he gives a pledge or a promise. God is not mocked. Mock means literally to turn up your nose, to sneer or scorn, to mock, to make a fool of, to disdain or to trust or to treat with contempt. You know, the kind of situation you think of that mocking is when a student at school, the teacher comes up and gives him an assignment, and the kid just lifts up his eyes, lifts up his nose, and turns his head like, you know, what, who are you to tell me something like that? Or parents, I'm sure, have seen it with their children when you give them orders, tell them what to do, and they roll their eyes or shake their head, or that makes a parent's blood boil. I can attest to that. You know, when you reject the Word of God in any area of your life, you do not ultimately ridicule or make a fool of God. You're not making a fool of God when we reject His truth, when we snub God, we mock Him. But instead, the mud is on our face because we make a fool of ourselves before God. Remember, God is not mocked. The application of this, if you think about this, is in this particular passage where he was speaking to these church in Galatia. You know, salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, and Christ alone, in His finished work alone. And the legalists here of this church in Galatia turns up their nose at that, don't they? Why? Because it cuts at their religious pride. Since salvation is by God's grace alone, and you can do nothing by way of good works to earn this salvation or to stay saved, a legalist just turns up his nose and stubs his nose at it, doesn't he? Because it cuts directly at their religious pride. The only condition for salvation is faith alone in Christ alone. We know that, which means you're not saved by good works. And what's this do to a legalist? He turns up his nose at it. He's mocking God. And that's not a situation that you'd want to be at, I don't think. So the principle we're looking at here is, whatsoever a man sows, that he shall also reap. Let's see if we had some time to look at. Let's just look at a couple of these passages. Turn over in Hosea chapter 8. Hosea chapter 8. Hosea is one of the minor prophets after the book of Daniel, chapter 8, and in verse 7. These are some farming analogies that are in the Bible. Verse 7 says, they sow the wind and reap the whirlwind. The stock has no bud. It shall never produce meal. And if it shall produce, aliens would swallow it up. You didn't think the word aliens was in the Bible, did you? Aliens will swallow it up. Look over in verse 10, as long as we're in Hosea. Chapter 10, verses 12 and 13. Hosea 10, verses 12 and 13. Sow for yourself righteousness. Reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till he comes and rains righteousness on you. You have plowed wickedness. You have reaped iniquity. You have eaten the fruit of lies because you have trusted in your own way in the multitude of your mighty men. Change your mind. Change your mind. You know, three laws of harvest. One of the laws of harvest is something that we all know, and if we have a garden, we know that we're going to reap whatever we plant. Aren't we? We're going to reap whatever we plant. If we plant apples, we're going to get apples. We plant corn, we're going to get corn. We plant beans, we're going to get beans. We're not going to plant cucumbers and get lettuce, are we? It's just not going to happen. What I'm trying to say here is that you cannot sow a carnal seed and expect to reap a spiritual fruit. You can't sow to the law and reap the fruit of the Spirit. It's just totally opposite. Totally opposite. You know, we see over in Genesis 1:21, if you want to turn over there, Genesis chapter 1 and verse 21. This is talking about God when he created the earth. Genesis 1:21, it says, so God created sea creatures and every living thing that moves. He created it all. With which the waters abounded according to their kind. You see that word, according to their kind? According to their kind is when God was creating animals, that means that dogs aren't going to produce cats when they mate. Pigs aren't going to produce horses. Everything according to their kind. So that means there's a problem with the theology of evolution, and isn't it? There's a missing link there somewhere. The fact is that one thing is produced by the same thing validates this idea that we're teaching of reaping what you sow, reaping what you plant. A second principle on harvest is that you reap more than you plant. That's one of the hopes of a lot of us people that plant a garden, isn't it? You reap more than you plant. A grapevine produces bunches of grapes, doesn't it? It isn't just that when you plant grapes, a grapevine grows and it produces bunches of grapes. One stalk of corn yields how many years of corn? It yields multiple years of corn. So you always reap more than you plant. And the third law of harvest is that you usually reap in a different season, don't you? It's something that doesn't happen immediate. When you plant, it usually
the harvest time is in a different season. Let's turn back over to Galatians chapter 6. Let's look at that real close here. Galatians chapter 6. If you look at verse 8 again, it says, "For he who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption." Of the flesh reap corruption. You see that sow? That's a present tense word. And see that reap? The reaping here has a futuristic type of tense, type of idea. You know, some people expect to plant something and reap it immediately, but that's not the principle here. Everything that's planted, it takes time for that to mature, to grow, and to reap at a later time, doesn't it? "For because whatever man sows, that shall he also reap." You know, due to these three laws of harvest, and this principle we learned here, is that you can't get away with anything before a righteous and holy God. He knows everything about us. You know, you may think that sometimes that we're getting away with something, and that's not the case, because he knows everything, and it will reap negative or positive benefits down the road. You know, there's two soils here to consider. I don't know if this is on here. Yeah, two possibilities and two results. So we're talking about two different soils. You have two options here. You can either sow to the flesh, and you will of the flesh reap corruption, or you can sow to the Spirit. You know, into the flesh that we're talking about here is means you cater into the flesh. You're planting seeds of flesh in the ground, and pretty soon in harvest time, it will manifest itself. And this could be through legalism or license, because that's what this whole thing, this whole chapters or book previously to this chapter of Galatians is talk about. And the other option is you can sow to the Spirit and reap everlasting life. What's better? Sow into the Spirit, reap an everlasting life. This cooperating with the Holy Spirit, walking with the Spirit of God, being filled with the Spirit of God, embracing these truths of grace is what the idea here is. You know, this passage isn't talking about going to heaven, but instead it's talking about the quality of life we can live as believers in Christ on this earth. This word corruption means just exactly what it says when it talks about sowing to the flesh and reaping corruption. Corruption means a moral rottenness, bad fruit. It's sometimes used of decaying food. It stinks. It's something terribly horrible. And when we sow or cater to the flesh, this is what we're offering God, our Heavenly Father, this moral, stinking, corrupting thing. You know, when you plant something out in the garden, if you go out in the yard and you have gravelly sand in your yard and you plant corn there and you expect the corn to grow big and healthy, it's not going to happen, is it? But if you plant the corn in the fertile part of the soil near the river where the soil is rich and you fertilize it, it grows much better, doesn't it? And it's the same concept. It's just, where do you want to plant seeds? You know, sometimes carnal believers are banking on grace. They think that they will not reap what they sow, or they can get away with it for a while because our God is gracious. But he says here that we sow to the flesh, we will reap corruption. You know, this passage of scripture we just looked at here is very similar to the previous chapter in verse 5. When it talks in verse 5, verse 16, "And then I say, walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh." One or the other. Walk in the Spirit and you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. So it's the same type of thing, theology. If we sow to the flesh, the fruit of it's going to be something we don't want. It's corruption. But on the opposite side, we sow the Spirit. We see in chapter 5 and verse 22, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against there is no such law. So this is what God wants of us. Sowing to the Spirit, enjoying the fruit of the Spirit. You know, that's a fixed principle, something we all understand, is that fruit just doesn't happen overnight, does it? This passage is clearly talking about a qualitative type of life that takes time to build. When a person first trusts Christ as Savior, you're not going to have this type of relationship. So it's clearly qualitative, and it's also godly in quality. We can enjoy this life of fruit in the Spirit. You know, everlasting life we possess right now. This is qualitative life is like a marriage where when we first get married, you know, we got married at a pretty young age, Tammy and I, but yet as we grew up together and grew and loved one another, it gets better and better and better and better as you grow in your marriage, your love toward one another. And it's the same thing with our relationship towards Christ. As we learn more about Him, if we allow that to impact our thinking, it becomes better and better. Next, we're going to look at just a couple more passages of Scripture. He who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. You guys get that one? Next, we're going to look at just a couple more Scriptures here. 1 Timothy 6, verses 11 and 12. 1 Timothy 6, 11 and 12. It says, "But you, O man of God, flee these things and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, gentleness. Fight the good fight. Lay hold of eternal life to which you are called and have confessed a good confession of presence of many witnesses." You know, the idea here is lay hold of eternal life is get a grip on it. It's there. It's your possession. Grab it. Take it. Live it. Own it. It's something we can clearly enjoy in our life and the effects we can have if we lay hold of it. If we don't lay hold of it, we're going to spend eternity in heaven forever with Him, but we're not going to enjoy these fruits of the Spirit. Instead, we're going to be the opposite. We're going to sow to the flesh and reap corruption. Verses 1 Timothy 6, 17 through 19 says, "Command those who are rich in the present age not to be haughty, or to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who gives us richly all things to enjoy." Not to trust in uncertain riches. You notice this. Uncertain riches, something that we generate ourselves, but instead, God gives us richly all things to enjoy. You know, it's the source here. When they come from us, they're uncertain riches. When they come from God, they're described as rich, and we can enjoy them. Let them do good, and let them be rich in what? Not money, but in good works. Ready to give, willing to share, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may what? Futuristic tense? Lay hold of eternal life. Grab this life. Get a grip on this life. Enjoy it. You know, we need to live our whole life, our Christian life, in light of eternity, where our eye is always on that prize of eternity. You know, when our circumstances in life get bogged down, you know, I'm sure Pastor Sean's not having a whole lot of fun right now, but yet it's something you have to do. But in everything, we can give thanks. We can fall back on these principles. We can lay hold. We can get a hold. We can get a grip on this eternal life and enjoy that relationship we can have with the Spirit. And let the Spirit manifest some truth through us and show to the other, the one another's. You know, this isn't talking about possessing eternal life here. This is purely volitional. You have eternal life. This is talking about laying hold of eternal life. This is talking about getting a grasp on it and owning it and living it. Hope you guys all understood that. It didn't go too fast. Let's close in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time to open up your word. And we're so thankful for
Jesus Christ. We're so thankful that we can enjoy a qualitative eternal life. We can enjoy a life pleasing you through the Spirit of God. We just pray that we would have that mindset to want to sow to the Spirit, not to the flesh, and manifest them truths in us so that we could show that love to one another, and through that love that we would be able to also spread the gospel news, the good news of your salvation to them, so they can have a quantitative type of eternal life. We just pray that we would be ambassadors of that message. We would be servants, we'd be stewards, we'd be serving that message to any and all that will hear it, and we just pray for that boldness. We pray again for Pastor Sean down with his mother. Pray for his time with her. Pray that he has an opportunity to witness to her. And we pray that she does understand the gospel and trust Christ as her Savior. And we just pray for their safety and their wisdom down there. And again, we thank you for your time. And in Christ's name we pray. Amen. That's all I got. Oh, I had one more. I'm sorry.